Drum brakes, one of the most widely used brakes in today's automobile industries. Drum means a brake in which shoes press on the inner surface of the drum. When the shoes press on the outside of the drum, it is usually called a class brake. The automobile drum brake was first used in a car made by Mayhatch in the year 1900 and later patented in the year 1902 by Louis Renault. Self-adjusting drum brakes were introduced in the year 1950. As you can see from the animation, this is how drum brakes are useful in stopping a wheel. The wheel cylinder expands and it acts on the wall of the inner surface of the wall and is able to stop the wheel. This is the construction of a drum brake. There are various parts which make up a drum brake. The main parts includes the backing plate, the primary and the secondary shoes, the return springs, the wheel cylinder assemblies. This is the exploded view of the drum brakes. Backing plate. It provides base for other components. It increases the rigidity of whole setup and supports the housing and protects from foreign materials like dust. It absorbs the torque from braking action, and that is why backplate is also called as the torque plate. Brake drum. Made of cast iron, which is also heat conductive and wear resistant. It rotates along with wheel and axle. When a driver applies brake, the lining pushes radially against the inner surface of the drum, ensuring slowdown due to friction. Wheel cylinder. One wheel cylinder operates the brake on each wheel. The leading shoe is called the primary shoe and the trailing shoe is called the secondary shoe. Hydraulic pressure from the master cylinder acts on the piston cup, pushing the pistons towards the shoes, forcing them against the drum. As you can see, as the wheel cylinder expands, the shoes act on the inner surface and are able to stop it. And these are also the return springs. And this is a self-adjusting system of drum brakes. Brake shoe. Brake shoes are typically made up of two pieces of steel welded together. The crescent shaped piece is called the web and contains holes and slots in different shapes for return springs and hold down hardware. Each brake assembly has two shoes, a primary and a secondary shoe. Primary shoe is located towards the front of the vehicle and has lining position differently from the secondary shoe. Materials that make up the brake shoe are powdered metal such as lead, zinc, brass and aluminium. Working principle of drum brakes. The drum brake stops the tire from rotating by using hydraulic pressure transmitted from the master cylinder to the wheel cylinder to press the brake shoe against the drum brake, which is rotating along with the tire. When the hydraulic pressure to the wheel cylinder disappears, the force of the return spring pushes the shoe away from the inner surface of the drum and returns it to the original position. Advantages of drum brake. Due to simple in construction, it can be easily repairable. And due to the fact that the drum brake's friction contact area is at the circumference of the brake, a drum brake can provide more braking force than an equal diameter disc brake. Disadvantages. The use of many clips and springs makes overhaul of the brake drum assembly very time consuming. Another problem with drum brakes is that if the vehicle comes in contact with water, then the braking efficiency reduces, or it takes longer time for the brakes to work effectively. When the drums are heated by hard braking, the diameter of the drum increases slightly due to thermal expansion. This means the brake shoes have to move farther and the brake pedal has to be depressed further.
So now we are going to discuss about another type of brake, which is somewhat a upgraded version of drum brake. This is the disc brake. So first we will see what is the basic configuration of a disc brake. A disc brake basically has a disc-shaped metal rotor spinning within a wheel when pressure is applied to the brake pedal. A caliper will squeeze the brake pads against the disc to stop the vehicle or reduce its speed. This arrangement has got various advantages over drum brakes. inspection work is very easy, and we do not have to remove the wheels in order to look at the disc brake system. In the case of the drum brake, we have to remove the whole assembly so that we can repair the brake shoes or any other part. But the main reason this system has been developed is because it provides more stopping power than the drum brakes. We can also add more disc, dual discs to add to the stopping power. Also, since the contact area in braking with disc and calipers is much lower than the drum brakes, there is less dissipation as heat and we get more braking power. Also, in drum brakes, there is more chance of brake fade to happen as the brakes loses its effectiveness due to excessive heat of brake drum that causes it to expand and losing braking ability. This happens much faster in this brake because of more contact area and thus more heat and friction generation. Drum brake also has potential to collect water inside during rain. This results in the drum brakes not performing well in wet conditions. So now we are going to discuss the configuration of the disc brake in detail. This brake mainly consists of three main parts, which is caliper assembly, brake pads and rotor. So the disc rotor is the rotating part of the wheel's disc brake assembly, against which the brake pads are applied. The material is typical grey iron, a form of cast iron. The design of the discs varies somewhat. Some are simply solid but others are hollowed out with fins or vanes joining together the disc to contact surfaces. The weight and power of the vehicle determines the need for ventilated discs. The ventilated disc design helps to dissipate the generated heat and is most commonly used in the more heavily loaded front discs. Brake caliper is the assembly which houses the brake pads and pistons. The pistons are usually made of plastic, aluminium, steel. This is the basic configuration of a caliper assembly. So calipers are of two types, floating or fixed. A fixed caliper does not move relative to the disc and is thus less tolerant of disc imperfections. It uses one or more pairs of opposing pistons to clamp from each side of the disc and is more complex and expensive than a floating caliper. In this diagram, we can see a floating caliper disc. So a floating caliper disc moves with respect to the disc along a line parallel to the axis of rotation of the disc. A piston on one side of the disc pushes the inner brake pad until it makes contact with the braking surface, then pulls the caliper body with the outer brake pad, so pressure is applied to both sides of the discs. So the brake pads are designed for high friction with brake pad material embedded in the disc in the process of bedding while wearing evenly. Friction experienced by the brake pad is adhesive as well as abrasive. Depending on the properties of the material of both pad and the disc and the configuration, the usage pad and disc wear rates will vary considerably. The properties that determine the material wear involve trade-offs between performance and longevity. So as you can see in this animation, the basic mechanism of a disc brake is that when we press the brake pedal, the fluid from the master cylinder is forced into a caliper where it presses against a piston. The piston in turn crushes two brake pads against the disc that is being attached to wheel, making it to stop or slow down.
So now we are going to discuss about the power brakes. Power brakes are very useful to increase the efficiency of the braking system. It uses vacuum from the engine or from any other source to multiply the force that our foot applies to the master cylinder. Important parts of the system are brake booster, check valve and diaphragm. So here we can see that the power brake system. Most cars had drum brakes. Power brakes were not really necessary. Most car uses the disc brake in front wheel. They need power brakes. Without this, a lot of drivers would have tired legs. The brake booster uses the vacuum from the engine to multiply the force that your foot applies to the master cylinder. The vacuum booster is a metal cylinder that contains a valve and a diaphragm. Chuck valve is a one-way valve that only allows air to be sucked out of the vacuum booster. If the engine is turned off or if a leak from the vacuum hose, the chuck valve makes sure that air does not enter the vacuum booster. Vacuum booster needs vacuum source to operate. The brake pedal pushes a rod that pushes the booster into master cylinder, actuating master cylinder piston. The engine creates a partial vacuum inside the vacuum booster or both sides of the diaphragm. When you hit the brake pedal, the rod cracks open the valve, allowing the air to enter the booster on one side of the diaphragm. As we can see in this diagram, this increases the pressure and on that side of the diaphragm so that it helps to push the rod, which in turn pushes the piston into the master cylinder. As the brake pedal is released, the valve seals off the outside air supply while reopening the vacuum valve. This restores the vacuum on both sides of the diaphragm, allowing everything to return on its original position. Now we discuss about clutches. They are used for changing the gear while engine is running. They prevent the wear and tear of the gears while changing the gear. They also relax the necessity of turning off of engine while we apply the brakes to the vehicle. They work on the principle of friction. So this is the view of the disengaged clutch. The very first principle on which a clutch works is the friction. When two friction surfaces are brought in contact and pressed, then they are united and start revolving at the same speed due to friction between them. The driving member of the clutch is flywheel mounted on the engine crankshaft, and the driven member is the pressure plate mounted on the transmission shaft. The three main parts required to fulfill the function, these are known as the principal parts of the clutch. The first part is the driving member. It is directly connected to the crankshaft. It consists of the cover which carries pressure plate, pressure spring, the releasing lever. The second part is the driven member. It consists of the plate which is free to slide lengthwise on the splines of the clutch shaft, but which drives on the shaft through these splines. The plate is called the friction plate. Clutch housing also includes the driven member. Third part is the operating member. It connects the driver to the whole assembly. It consists of foot pedal, the linkage, the release lever, and the springs necessary to ensure proper orientation of the clutch. Now this slide shows the modeling of the clutch. The modeling of the clutch is done using the two principles. The first is the uniform pressure, and the second is the uniform wear condition. An uniform pressure is used when the clutch is new, and the uniform wear condition is generally used when the clutch is old and it has worn and torn out. The uniform pressure theory states that the torque is equal to the FFA 2/3 R0 cube minus R1 cube upon R0 square minus R1 square. And the uniform wear condition states that the torque is equal to FFA into R0 plus R1/2, where small f is the friction coefficient and the capital F is the force applied. Thank you.